Morning. Welcome to our celebration of the second Sunday of Easter here at St. Julie's. Please download the worship aid from either there or down there. Please join in singing along with us and praying. Please rise as we sing our gathering hymn, Jesus Christ is Risen Today.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you always.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters in Christ, greetings and welcome on this Divine Mercy Sunday, the Sunday of Divine Mercy, when Jesus calls us back in a particular and profound way. He calls us back to place our trust in Him. He calls us back to recognize that, you know, wherever we've been in our life, in our challenges, in our struggles, He's waiting. He's waiting for us. You know, this gift of divine mercy was given to the Universal Church by Pope John Paul II, and it's based in private revelations to St. Faustina Kowalska. And in those private revelations, Jesus referred to, he made reference to a spark from Poland to prepare the world for his second coming. That is this gift of divine mercy. Trusting in God's great mercy, we call to mind our sins. We seek his mercy and pardon to prepare our hearts to celebrate these sacred mysteries.
Lord Jesus,
us to everlasting life. Let us pray. God of everlasting mercy, who in the very recurrence of the Paschal Feast kindle the faith of the people you have made your own, increase, we pray, the grace you have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font they have been washed, by whose Spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. They devoted themselves to the teaching of the apostles and to the communal life, to the breaking of bread and to the prayers. Awe came upon everyone, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their property and possessions and divide them among all according to each one's need. Every day they devoted themselves to meeting together in the temple area and to breaking bread in their homes. They ate their meals with exultation and sincerity of heart, praising God and enjoying favor with all the people. And every day the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the first letter of Saint Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy gave us a new birth to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by the power of God are safeguarded through faith to a salvation that is ready to be revealed in the final time. In this you rejoice, although now for a little while you may have to suffer through various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold, that is perishable even though tested by fire, may prove to be for praise, glory, and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Although you have not seen him, you love him. Even though you do not see him now, indescribable and glorious joy as you attain the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked where the disciples were, for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive are forgiven them, and whose sins you retain are retained." Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger into the nail marks, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now, a week later, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and bring your hand and put it into my side. And do not be unbelieving, but believe." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed. Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. But these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. During this time, many of us may be experiencing panic and anxiety or fear, and so we look for places of comfort. One thing I recommend to you that's very much part of our Christian tradition is Psalm 23, I think you know well, as a place to look for comfort. The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want. In verdant pastures he gives me repose. By restful waters, he leads me. Even though I walk through the valley of death, I fear no evil, for the Lord is with me. Take comfort in the words of Psalm 23. And I fear no evil, for the Lord is with me. What a beautiful image in today's gospel, where even though the apostles were afraid and locked in the room, Jesus is in their midst to say, peace be with you. And so let these be sources of comfort. Jesus in the midst of the apostles, the risen Lord in the midst of the apostles. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. And when I think of places of comfort, where I'm at in life right now, one of the places where I find that comfort is when I go to visit a friend of mine. Father Adam Quintel, that is just a time to kind of step back and remember the good things of the Lord, remember the things that are beautiful, the things that refresh the soul, a place of comfort. I find it with my friend Adam. Or you might think of this idea of a sanctuary as a safe place. Sanctuary means a safe place. And, John Paul II referred to the family as a sanctuary of life, the sanctuary of life, a safe place for life to grow, to develop, to move towards its fulfillment. And so it's in the context of a safe place or of comfort that I want to talk today about the Sabbath, the family, the Eucharist, as ways to foster a safe place, for us in whatever circumstances might be going around us in our life, to be able to find a safe place in the Sabbath, in the family, in the Eucharist. Sabbath means day of rest. So if you remember when the Lord first commanded the Sabbath, he said, he referred to creation. 7 days the Lord did the work of creation, and on the six days the Lord did the work of creation, and on the seventh day he rested. And that's the model for the Sabbath day, a day of rest. And when we think of the Sabbath, we also, think of our Lord Jesus, when he was challenged by the Pharisees. He said, the Sabbath was created for man, not man for the Sabbath. And what he's getting at is, Sabbath was created for man. There's something about us that needs a place of rest, a place of comfort. And God, who made us, knows this. And so he set aside this day of rest. First the seventh day, and then with the resurrection of Jesus, the day of resurrection, the first day. But a Sabbath is a day of rest. But we've gotten away from that. You know, there's so many things pulling us in so many directions. Or there had been prior to the world shutting down. So many things pulling us in so many directions that we lost the gift of the Sabbath. And so I think this is a bold claim, but I think one of the graces, one of the mercies that God wants to give us during this time of pandemic is to rediscover the Sabbath. That we lost sight of it. The Lord says, I want to give it back to you. And we have a model for this in Scripture, in the people of the Old Covenant. You know, God said, I'm the Lord your God, do not have strange gods. And when they lost sight of the God of Israel, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, the God who brought them out of Egypt, they started to get pulled toward the other gods of the false gods of the Canaanites. God exiled them from the land. And that might be a model for the grace that God wants to give us now. With our preoccupation with work, with productivity, with progress, with a lot of the ideas of the modern world, we got pulled away from the Sabbath. And here's a time when the Lord exiles us from our work to rediscover the Sabbath. It's a bold claim, but that could be a grace, a mercy that God wants to restore to us. There's something about having a Sabbath rest built into our lives that's irreplaceable. And that's why God commanded the third of the Ten Commandments, keep holy the Sabbath day. We need it. Jesus, you know, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. But it was also very much a part of the lived experience of the people of God. You know, whether the Jewish people keeping their Sabbath day in a Roman Empire when, you know, they'd have been seemed like outsiders for taking that day off. Or in our own day, yeah, or in the days of the apostles, you know, the Sabbath was built into the life of those first Christians. You know, in our first reading today, we said every day they would go to the temple, they would meet in the temple area. But they had that meeting together. Or we think about in our gospel, what day was it? Both times that Christ appeared to them, on the first day of the week, the day of the resurrection. The apostles, the disciples were gathered together on the first day of the week. That the Sabbath was a cornerstone of those early Christians. And that's why Sunday, the Sabbath, the Sunday, remains the cornerstone of our liturgical year, our liturgical calendar, that little Easter every Sunday. And that's why, you know, going to Mass on Tuesday or Thursday isn't the same as going to Mass on Sunday. Because we need a Sabbath rest. I think one of the graces, one of the mercies that God wants to give us during this time of pandemic is to restore us to an authentic Sabbath rest. A day to remember what are the things that give us life. A day to remember to put your people first. A day to really focus on our relationships, the most important relationships in our life, with God, with a spouse, with children and parents, to build that sanctuary. And so the Sabbath, God gives us the Sabbath as a place to find comfort, rest, and a safe place. And so in terms of the family, are we able to find rest in our homes, in our families? And I mean, I know that it gets very hectic with the needs of the other family members. It can be hectic, but you know, is there a sense of this is a place where I'm loved? This is a place where I belong. This is a place where you know there's a sense of order in the sense of you're not constantly distracted here and there, but where you can just live life with the people you love. This idea of family, you know, and it's interesting, you know, I'll say some, this might be a little bit provocative where I go with this, but, you know, one of the, there's a lot of strange things during this time. And so I'm in contact with my friends. It's a couple, I convalidated their marriage 6 years ago. But during this time, the gentleman was furloughed from his work. I mean, I know many of you are experiencing that pain of furlough. But then on the other hand, the wife has a job where, because of the coronavirus, extra work is falling on her. And so when I was in contact with the other day, the wife, you know, joked about having a house husband. You know, whether it's a husband or a wife, I mean, there's something to be said about making the home a priority. You know, there's many people have many gifts that they share, and that they share with the wider world through avenues of work, but we lost something when we wouldn't have someone dedicated to making that house a home. Now, C.S. Lewis said that, you know, homemaker is the ultimate profession. All other professions exist for that one. And, you know, I started with the example of my friends because it doesn't have to be strict generals, but we lost something. You know, I don't know the best way forward, but we lost something. Because, I mean, if you think about it, if you come home from work and then you're overwhelmed with the tasks of keeping a home, of preparing a meal, of doing the dishes, all the things that go along with that, when is your sanctuary? When is your rest? And so we lost something. I don't know the best way forward. But simply to say that, you know, the family is intended to be a place of sanctuary, a place of rest, a place of Sabbath and renewal. And it's not a bad idea to have people who focus on that work, if we're able to do that, if circumstances allow it. But that the family, too, would be a place where we find authentic life. You know, I point out, you know, when I talk about a safe place or a place of comfort, for me, it was visiting my friend Adam. So being connected to the people that we value most. And in that sense, families can be a beautiful way of fostering a safe place, a place of comfort. And then I mentioned the idea of the Eucharist. That, you know, we're looking for places of comfort. You know, in our second reading, you know, the Apostle Peter wrote to the early Christians, and he recognized that there are times of trial, times of suffering. You know, many of us are experiencing that now, whether it's missing the sacraments, whether it's, you know, being furloughed from work, whether it's, you know, extra demands with the kids at home, but whatever it is, you know, many of us are experiencing suffering and trials. And Peter spoke to that in our second reading when he said, in this, referring to, you know, the hope of eternal life, when he refers to an imperishable, undefiled reward, in this, something in it, that eternal reward, you rejoice. Although now for a little while, you may have to suffer through various trials, so the genuineness of your faith may prove to be for praise, glory, and honor. And St. Peter, in that time of trial, was telling people to remember the great gift, the great hope we've received through our baptism into Christ Jesus. That hope for eternal life, but also in that sense of, you know, so that the genuineness of your faith may prove to be for the praise and the glory and the honor of God. That is our end. That is what we're striving for. That is what we're, you know, growing into in this process of maturing in Christ. To live to the praise and glory of God. And it's easy to lose sight of that. And again, when do we remember it? At the Sabbath. in that Sabbath rest. We remember, we're here to know a God who created us out of love, a God who redeemed us out of love, a God who has given us this gift of eternal life, and to praise Him. Where do we remember this? In the Eucharist. You know, in the trials, the sufferings that the early Christians were experiencing, Peter pointed them to something eternal and imperishable. The Eucharist is where the eternal meets the present. In the Eucharist, where Jesus comes in our midst to say, "Peace be with you." Jesus comes in our midst in the Eucharist, the body and blood, soul and divinity of Jesus, to be in our presence. That the bread from heaven, the ultimate place of rest, is present to us in the Eucharist. These past 3 weeks or so have been very difficult. They've been difficult for me too. And so in the midst of this difficulty, we look for a place of comfort. But we also have this opportunity, this grace, this mercy to cultivate, foster, build into our lives those moments of rest. And we remember and invest in the relationships that mean the most to us. And that is an invitation during this time. And to keep in mind that as we look for these places of comfort, the role of the Sabbath, the role of the family is a place to belong, to be loved. And the role of the Eucharist is a place where Jesus comes in our midst to assure us, to say to us, "Peace be with you." Let us profess the faith that has come to us as a great gift. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God of God, light of light, true God of true God, begotten not made, consubstantial of the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Jesus, in your risen glory, you enter into our midst to provide for us and to meet us in our time of need. And so we come before you, we trust, we place our trust in you.
For the church, the people of God, may they be open to how the Holy Spirit leads them to continue Jesus' saving mission. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of the world, may they grow in believing in the goodness and forgiveness of God and come to salvation. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who suffer, during the current pandemic. The sick, the suffering, the doubting, and the despairing. May they be lifted up by the ministry of those who believe. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the elect, may they always give thanks for the mercy of God, who gives them hope in the resurrection of Jesus. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our pastor regent, may we be a source of forgiveness and an instrument of peace and a faithful temple of the Holy Spirit. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for all those who have died, may they be in the presence of the peace of Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O God, look with love and mercy upon your church. Receive the prayers of your people, for yet who trust in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Oh,
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and of all of his holy church.
Accept, O Lord, we pray, the oblations of your people, and of those that renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world. Together with your servant Francis, our Pope, Dennis, our Bishop, and Joseph, his assistant, and all those holding to the truth, hand on Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, that they offered for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. Celebrating the most sacred day, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ in the flesh, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread,
and gave it to his disciples to say, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Your servants and your holy people offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them as once you are pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, holy sacrifice, spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, through this participation at the altar, receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing.
Remember also, Lord, your servants, who have gone before you with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share and fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, O Lord, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon.
Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Savior's command informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, to await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
With the kingdom,
the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal sacrament may have a continuing effect in our minds and in our hearts, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So, reminders before the final blessing. While public masses are suspended, we'll continue to live stream our masses at 10 a.m. You can access those through the web pages, or you can go directly to our YouTube channel for St. Julie Billiard Parish. Also, I'll continue to put out a video on Wednesday evenings, in addition to our streamed liturgies. So that's a place you can look. Today is a Divine Mercy Sunday, so I recommend to you and to your family praying the Chaplet of Divine Mercy at some time today, at a time that's appropriate. We have that beautiful image that's on loan to us from St. Joseph's Church, so we can have Divine Mercy with us today, an image of Divine Mercy with us today. And to continue to encourage one another, and to live out that great commandment of love with those to whom you do interact during these days, whether by phone or the people that you see face to face in your home, or for those who are still at work, to keep that law of charity so that Christ may be seen in us. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow for the blessing.
May God, who by the resurrection of his only begotten Son, was pleased to confer on you the gift of redemption and of adoption, give you gladness by his blessing.
Amen.
May he, by whose redeeming work you have received the gift of everlasting freedom, make you heirs to an eternal inheritance.
Amen.
May you, who have already risen with Christ in baptism through faith, by living in a right manner on this earth, be united with him in the homeland of heaven.
Amen.
May the blessing of Almighty God, the